So let's recap what has happened so far. In the previous video, we downloaded the NYU test dataset. This is a pure resting state dataset, and we created a new comp project where we imported both the functional and structural data from this project, and we have preprocessed it. And preprocessing involves realignment, slice timing correction, and the outlier identification, normalization, segmentation, and smoothing. And now we're going to look at the results of these preprocessing steps and just make sure that everything looks fine and how to evaluate that. And then we're going to move on to denoising. So let's do that first. This is the functional data. Now it looks a little bit blurry, and this is because it has been spatially smooth. Another thing that you should notice is that if preprocessing works fine, then the data should be in M&I space. So when we repeat the previous step of just displaying the single slice for all subjects, now we should be seeing what appears to be actually the same slice across multiple subjects, because the different planes are in the same spatial location, and different the same slice should correspond to the same place in the brain across multiple subjects, and this is what we are seeing here. Another way to evaluate this same thing is to look at this display, the functional tool, select the one that is called Slice Viewer with M&I boundaries, and then select dataset 1 just to display the unsmooth data, functional data. Then you're going to look at the functional data overlaid with the M&I boundaries. M&I boundaries represent the 25% boundaries of where the gray matter should be or would be expected to be if the brain was on actually M&I space. And you should see a reasonably good match between the M&I boundaries of the brain and the actual functional data after it has been normalized. So this is how it looks. And you can repeat all of these plots for every subject. And this is what the quality assurance plots, if you click here, allows you to basically create all of these quality assurance plots in a simpler manner and evaluate them in a very simple manner. But we will see that another day. Today, I just want to quickly browse through how the data looks after the normalization. This is how the structural looks. The structural also has been normalized, and that means that it has been the skull has been stripped, and all of their brains are in the same space. If you look across brains, again, can select the structural tools, display single slice for all subjects to look at the same slice across multiple subjects, and that should roughly represent the same position in the brain for all of the subjects. You can also select a slice viewer with M&I boundaries to display for that individual subject the M&I boundaries and how they look with respect of the actual structural data, and that should also give you a very good match between those boundaries and the on the template and the actual structural data for that subject after it has been normalized. Okay, so this is both the structural and functional data normalized. In addition to actually normalizing and correcting for motion and all of these things from the structural functional data, a lot of information, there are other three sources of information that have been changed in your comp process automatically by the preprocessing step. The first one is in ROIs. You have conn has created now three ROIs for you. They are called gray matter, white matter, and CSF, and they contain these three tissue classes for each subject. So this is a mask of gray matter voxels for subject 1, this subject 2, subject 3. And all of these have been created by the segmentation step as part of preprocessing. You can again display single slice for all subjects if you want to, and that should give you again a good match between the gray matter voxels across multiple subjects. This is what we are seeing here. And the same for white matter and CSF. These are a set of the other ROIs that come by default in conn, and it's just a set of Harvard Oxford Atlas ROIs, and this is a set of networks derived from independent component analysis. These are not subject specific, these are actually an M&I space as well. Okay, this is the first thing that has been added in by the preprocessing steps, these three masks. Another thing that has been added to your project automatically by preprocessing are these first level covariates. The first one is called realignment, and that contains the actual subject movement parameters estimated across time. So these are time series representing how the subject moved within the scanner, and these are different, of course, for each subject, and these have been estimated by realignment. Then you have this quality assurance time series that represent two things. The first thing is how the global signal in the pulse signal in the brain is changing from one scan to the next, and it's a measure of potential to identify potential outliers, places where there are a lot of changes in the pulse signal between one scan and the next are good indicators of that something went wrong with the image. And the second time series is the frame-wise displacement. It's a measure of how much the subject moved from one scan to acquisition to the next. So also again, high values represent a lot of motion between two adjacent scans, and that is a good indication of potential outliers. And scrubbing is actually the identification of potential outliers in these two time series. This is the result of ART, the outlier identification step. And it basically identifies a few scans that might have been potential outliers because they have either a lot of motion in the subject or a lot of global signal changes. And the last thing that has been added to your project automatically by preprocessing has been this covariate. You have now a number of quality assurance covariates that represent different aspects of the quality of the data for each subject. This is the number of valid scans, how many valid scans remain after the outlier identification step has identified potential invalid scans. This is the opposite, the number of invalid scans. So basically you want this to be roughly constant or relatively similar across all of the subjects. If you see some subject that has a very low value compared to others, that's a potentially problematic subject to take into account. Then you also have max motion and mean motion. These are two measures that have to do with how much the subject, each subject moved. And these are basically a number per subject. These are your 25 subjects here. And mean motion is how much the subject has moved on average. Max motion is what it was, the maximum motion, that the maximum displacement of that subject in the scanner. And then you have two quality assurance measures that have to that tell you information about the global signal changes. What is the maximum global signal change across the scanner and what is the mean global signal change across the scanner? So again, if you see outlier subjects that moved a lot or that had a lot of global signal changes, those are potential identifications of subjects that might have some problem in the data and you might want to look at them in more detail, or you might want to use these covariates as control covariates to try to correct for potential difference between subjects in the amount of motion or in the amount of global signal changes and things like that. Okay, so all of this has been automatically done by preprocessing. At this step, the only thing that might remain if you have a more complex design would be to actually define your experimental conditions. If you have a pre-post design or you have a task design where you might have different tasks within the scanner, you might want to specify them here. This is a pure resting state data and we have a single session, so we don't have anything else to do right now. We are defining a single condition in our data, that is, we are calling it rest, this by default, and it encompasses the entire time series. Yeah, ready to go. We have already looked at the structural and functional data and they seem fine, no reason to be concerned so far, so we can move on to the denoising step. So to do that, we just click down here and then click start. And what this is going to do is going to perform a little bit of erosion on your white matter and CSF mask. It's going to extract the ROI signal for its subject, for all of the ROIs that we have defined. That includes both the white matter, CSF, gray matter, but also of the Harvard Oxford Atlas ROIs, as well as the network ROIs that we have defined. And then it's going to get all of our data ready for denoising. And this process takes about less than a minute per subject, so in this case it's going to take about 50 minutes. So let's just speed time a little bit and move on to the denoising step. So here we are at denoising. Denoising is where we clean up the data to get it ready for functional connective analysis. And like all of the preprocessing steps, which are really common steps that are applied to all functional data, all fMRI data, whether it's for functional connectivity analysis or for functional activation analysis, denoising is very specific to functional connectivity analysis. It's a set of techniques that have been developed over the last few years and have been proven to improve the quality and the replicability of functional connectivity measures, and they have been used almost exclusively in the context of functional connectivity analysis. And what denoising does is address a number of residual physiological and motion effects that are present and very salient and very clear on the data even after all of the processing steps. So let me show you that with this example. If we take this data that came from preprocessing and look at the ball signal across multiple voxels, and we compute functional correlations between every pair of voxels, and we just compute a histogram of the distribution of those correlations, we will get something like this gray histogram. And this is a histogram that shows that most voxels are correlated with everything is correlated with everything in the brain. So basically, the mean is close to 0.80 something or 0.9, and every voxel show very high correlations with everybody else. And if you look at that across subjects, different subjects are going to show different distributions. These are all the gray distributions that we're looking at. Some subjects show incredibly high correlations with every voxel, and some other subjects do not, and that changes a lot the shape and size of those distributions. And why is this happening? This is happening mostly because of residual physiological and subject motion effects. There are a number of residual effects that are global in nature, and when you have a global effect that is affecting your ball signal, you're going to have a lot of bias in your functional correlation measures, because the correlation are going to reflect the contribution of these global effects rather than the more subtle functional connectivity effects that you want to look at. So you really need to remove these very large and very salient global effects from the signal before being able to move on successfully to getting clean, meaningful functional connectivity measures. One of the methods, well, there are many methods that have been developed, and there are many methods that are available in the conn toolbox to do so, but the method that comes by default with all of the settings is called Anatomical Core, and what it's doing is extracting a representative noise signal from white matter regions and a representative noise signal from CSF, and it's going to be removing those anything that correlates with those noise components from the bulk signal for every voxel. And it's also going to remove anything that correlates with realignment parameters, the subject motion parameters that were estimated to realignment. And also it's going to remove anything that has to do that correlates with the scrubbing covariates. And basically this effectively takes out those outlier scans. This is called scrubbing. This is removing the influence or the effect of these individual outlier scans that have been deemed to be potential outliers. And all of these are removed in a single linear regression step, and the residuals of that linear regression are going to be your clean signal without the effect of all of these noise effects. And you can see that the effect that has on the functional connectivity measures is a very beneficial one, because now if you look at across different subjects, this is the distribution after denoising of the voxel-to-voxel correlations that looks very similar across all of the subjects, and it looks reasonably centered around zero, which is what you would expect. So basically you see distributions around zero and distributions that are very similar across subjects. So all of this huge difference between subjects influenced by the noise effects have been removed. So this is how you evaluate whether the denoising is doing what you would wanted to do. If you look at cross subjects, and if these distributions look reasonably centered and they look reasonably similar across subjects, then you are fine. You can also look at these carpet plots. This is showing bulk signal time series. This is the time dimension, and this is voxels. And you can see these patterns. When you see these patterns, that means that there are still some residual global effects on the signal. This is before the noising, and this is after the noising. So basically, after the noising, you shouldn't see any patterns. That's again an indication that everything is working fine. And you can do that across multiple subjects to see whether that is working as you would expect. You can also click on quality assurance plots and see whether these histograms automatically computed and kind of compare superimposed across all of the subjects to see whether that is working as you would expect. And this is the distribution of those voxel to voxel correlations before denoising, and this distribution after denoising. So in this case, you typically want to have distributions here that are similar across all of the subjects and center. And this is roughly what we get. We have one example here. This is subject 24 that seems to be a little bit different from the rest of the distribution, so we're going to pay a little bit more attention to that subject and see what is going on with that. Just as an example, it's not really a very big departure, but it's departure from the rest of the subjects, but it's just to show you what to do in those cases. Let's see that we do care about that. This is a little departure from other subjects, and it shows a little bit of bias towards the positive values. And if you just look at the carpet plots, it shows a little bit of a pattern here in the after the denoising plots. So you might want to worry about that. It's not really huge, but if you worry about that, how would you fix it? Typically, you can try changing the denoising parameters to improve that. And the most typical thing that works in these cases is to increase the number of white matter or CSF matter components that you extract from the white matter and CSF region. So let's go, for example, change this to, instead of 5 components, let's extract 10 and see whether that has an effect. There we go. We see that now after the noising is a little bit better centered. So let's see whether that generalizes to other subjects or not. So let's create the quality assurance plots again and look at the distribution, the voxel to voxel correlation across all of the subjects, and there we go. Now we see that all of that individual subject that was a little bit off from the rest seems to have been corrected. So this looks perfectly fine. And then this is a good indication that your data is possibly as good as it can be and is all ready for doing functional connected analysis. So another thing that I'm going to change here, just to show you how to do that, because it's something that I typically do. I typically care about high frequency of the signal, because I'm just interested in what is going on at those highest frequencies. So even though the default bandpass filtering options in many functional connectivity analysis is set to focus on the frequency range of 0.01 hertz to 0.10 hertz approximately, I want to change that and use just a high pass filtering so that we look at high pass high frequencies as well. So I just change this to inf. So I'm gonna change that to 0.01 to inf. And that is the range that I want to look at high frequency. This also gives me a little much more degrees of freedom for my data, so that improves a little bit of the quality of the denoising and the connective tissue. So that is all that is needed here. When you are satisfied with how everything looks here, you can just move on and click done, and then click start. And that is going to apply this denoising procedure to all of your subjects, and it's going to take just about 10 seconds per subject, so overall it's going to take about 5 minutes on this particular data set. And that's going to take us to first level analysis and second level results, where we can are actually going to start running functional, computing functional connectivity measures and looking at those measures across multiple subjects and seeing how those look. So, see you. Thank you very much for listening, and see you in the next video.